on Sean is a fresher breath there. He just loves chain restaurants.
Matter of fact, he ate at Applebee's 12 times during the bye week.
I love each and every most of you guys.
That really is still swollen, isn't it?
It's all swollen.
It kind of looks like a football, actually.
Thank you for that.
Stitching, you got it.
Thank you.
Hey, D, I like donuts, baby. Let's go.
Stay focused. Work hard in school. You might not like school, but make sure you're working hard at school.
It builds a bomb. It builds a bomb.
It's your boy DM3, and you're listening to the Witty, Not Funny Sports Podcast on the Built in Buffalo Podcast Network.
Witty Nation, welcome everyone to episode 85 of the Witty Not Funny Sports Podcast, the number one self-rated podcast about sports, entertainment, and everything in between. And as always, part of the Built in Buffalo Podcast Network. Go follow us at Witty Sports 716 on Twitter and Instagram. Follow everything Built in Buffalo family is giving you on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, wherever you can find Built in Buffalo. You could find Witty Not Funny Sports. We are your hosts, of course. I am Matt Greco. He is Tony Ambrose. Tony, what is going on?
Somebody call 312-8908. What's up, Witty Nation? Oh, what's up, Matt? What's up, Witty Nation? Great to be here. Great to chat with you gentlemen tonight.
It's very different from whoever's the listening. Irish ballad that you gave us last week.
Well, you know, I have a diverse musical library in my mind, I guess. I'm pretty eclectic in what I got going on musically.
It's very eclectic. Mm-hmm.
It's a point of pride.
It's a point of pride is right. Tony, before we get into Bills news, because there's quite a bit of Bills news. Free agency continued this week for Brandon Beane and company. We have some old faces returning, getting the gang back together. We have a couple new faces filling vital roles. We have Beane talking about Von Miller. The Von Miller party continues. But before we get into that, do we have to talk about the Sabres? Like, the Sabres are good again. They're 7-3 in their last 10. They're having a moment, is right. 7-3 in their last 10. And I think for the first time in, 10, 12 years, they look like they're having fun and we're having fun with them. We don't talk about the Sabres a lot on this podcast unless something major happens. I feel like this is the start of something major happening with this team.
I think it's interesting the way that you put it when you say the start of something major. To me, it's very reminiscent. Like, I'm just waiting to hear members of the old guard saying things like they did in 03 to 05-ish when they were just saying, it's just kids playing hockey. Like, they're having such a good time. And then that spurred on, a whole era as they got older and we grew up with them. So I think that you're thinking this is finally seems like it could be the start of a new era. And I'm having a great time with it.
They do seem like a really fun group at the Heritage Classic, mm-hmm. the outdoor game against the Maple Leafs. They arrive to the game all in their Jackie Moon garb, all wearing semi-pro Flint Tropics jerseys. And I don't think you get that from, I guess I'd call it the Jack Eichel era teams. But Jack was a bigger problem than I'm guessing any of us could have imagined at this point. Just on the ice and off the ice.
Yeah. That's kind of what it seems like. And it's interesting now how it's kind of like getting brought together under that narrative. You know, I'm certainly appreciating everyone who has the feel-good take of we're 7-3 in our last 10 and Vegas is 3-7 in their last 10. And clearly that's Jack Eichel. And of course, the Jack Eichel video clip, that GIF that's going around everywhere of him in the interview. It's kind of interesting to me because many times did we see or refer to Jack Eichel as sort of the chosen one or the prophet that we were waiting for. And in many ways, this could be, I hope, him fulfilling his destiny as the chosen one, but in like a Darth Vader way. He does bring the balance back to the Force. Just not in the way that you intended, just not in the way that you thought as bringing it to the light side of things. Right. But he ends
in
up
the way
doing
James
it
Earl
by,
Jones attended.
Yes, exactly. He ends up doing it by turning his back within the dark side. And that's kind of what Jack is doing. He's creating himself to be the enemy to bring order back to the Force.
That's exactly the narrative that I thought when we played the Vegas Golden Knights and Jack's big return to Buffalo, that post game press conference from Jack after the Sabres beat the Knights.
Oh, stuff of
it legend. Was a little petty talking about how this is the first time he's heard the fans cheer in what, 7 years or whatever. He guess he just had to leave for them to start cheering. Man,
yeah, maybe he's exactly
how,
right.
How old is that kid? Like 12 or 26 or whatever he is. Yeah, he is painting himself to be the villain, and maybe that's just what this organization needed. A bunch of good guys now that needed a villain to really get in the good graces of this city.
Now, what I'm surprised you didn't bring up was Peyton Krebs announcing the starters. Did you see this? Do you not know what I'm talking
this.
About?
No. Did you see this? Oh, did you hear about it? No, I haven't seen this or heard about this.
I'll send you the video. It's Peyton Krebs in the locker room, and everyone's like kind of clapping in unison in a syncopated rhythm. And he's announcing and hyping up like, we got Tuck at left wing. Who we got? We got Tejas at, like, he's doing it in this weird, it's not weird. It's just an excitable kind of introducing of people.
Monster truck rally
like a game show.
Sunday. That sounds fun.
Check out the video to you, Matt. And listeners, if you haven't seen it, check out the old video.
We will check that out together. That sounds fun. Again, just they seem to be having fun. Alex Tuck.
Fun is the word.
Comes over from Vegas.
Love him.
He's a future captain, obviously. Like, he's almost a point per game guy during his time with the Sabres here. You have a great prospect pool. I mean, again, we don't talk about this team unless something major happens, and it feels like the start of something good, finally, for this organization. Mm-hmm. I look back at those Brière-Drury years. I was in college. That series against Ottawa, when we went to the Eastern Conference Finals, lost to the Hurricanes because we were down to our 10th defenseman or whatever. I was literally running up and down the halls of Park Hall at Ohio State University, and nobody knew what the heck was going on because I was the only Buffalo Sabres fan in the dorm. But it feels like that we're getting to those times again, or we could be getting to those times again. And those are some of the best times. Those parties in the Plaza were amazing. Drury scoring with like 2 seconds left in the playoffs. If we could get back to those for the first time ever, knock on wood, because it's never happened before, have two good major league organizations, sports organizations in this city at once.
Let's not go crazy, because you know that's not allowed.
It's not allowed, right?
Everyone knows that's not allowed.
I know.
But it would be
Universal not let us have that.
Right. It would be a heck of a lot of fun. And I hope it will be a heck of a lot of fun. Really, I just want the new generation of Sabres fans to like understand, hey, this was a team that was very important to us for a long time.
Right.
Don't mess it up, you know?
Good point. Yeah, right. Don't mess this up. And if Alex Tuck and Josh Allen become best friends in the process.
Wow. Yeah. And of course, not best friends, but worst enemies when Josh. Yeah, exactly. The captain video when Josh Allen decided that he hated Jack Eichel.
As we're well aware of now, Josh has very good intuition.
Absolutely. Maybe Josh should spend a little time in the Sabres front office.
He was spot on. Tony, the Sabres are hot. Before we get into the Bills, let's bring back our Hansel Award.
Hansel. So hot right now. Hansel.
Hansel Award, of course, we give out to what is hot in the sports world, because as every fan of Zoolander knows, as you and I know, Hansel, just so hot right now. Always just so
hot. He's so hot right now.
So hot. Tony, would you like to do the honors? Who are you giving your Hansel Award to?
I'm giving my Hansel Award to something that maybe has creeped its way out of the Ecto-1 or out of the box. This is something that I have to give my award to because it is rising and hitting its moment. And that is something maybe many of us didn't even know existed until
PG,
this week.
Tony, it's a PG show.
It's the insurance curse.
Ooh, like
dun,
it.
Dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun.
The insurance curse. If you are a representative or spokesman or an endorser of an insurance company, you have a curse on you. You got screwed this week.
That's the insurance
curse is rising. Of course, we have Aaron Rodgers losing Devontae Adams. Of course, we have Baker Mayfield losing his job. Swing it back to State Farm. And you got Patrick Mahomes losing Tyreek Hill. Loss or damage, not covered by these insurance companies. The Geico Gecko's days are numbered.
He's an endangered species now.
He's an endangered species now. Exactly. If you are endorsing an insurance company, watch out. Watch your back. Don't leave the house.
What about that Allstate guy with the deep voice? We got to watch out for him. He might be sounding like a chipmunk pretty soon. he's done.
Yeah. I mean, he's about to
always
get
into accidents.
He's about to get some swollen lymph nodes like you've never seen.
Who's the guy who always gets in accidents? Like the guy, he's riding the Peloton. Mayhem. Is that his name? Mayhem.
Yeah, his name is Mayhem.
He's on the Peloton. He flips through the glass door.
Of course.
What insurance does he represent? Does he represent insurance?
I believe it is insurance. His name is Dean Winters or
Dean Gerard Winters. All I know is he played Tina Fey's boyfriend on 30 Rock.
Yes. Well, I always remember him as, I believe it's the Vulture, might be the Falcon from Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
Oh, it is the Vulture. Yeah, from Brooklyn Nine-Nine as well. That's mm-hmm. right. He would come in and steal Andy Samberg's cases.
Well, I have something that's going to blow your mind over here. So his Wikipedia starts off with, he is best known for his role on the HBO prison drama Oz, the character Ryan O'Reilly.
Speaking of the Sabres.
Exactly. So, you know,
wow.
People who are going to the dark side and restoring balance. Whew, Mayhem. This is Mayhem. The insurance curse.
Mayhem/Ryan O'Reilly. All we have to hope for now is Josh Allen does not get endorsed by an insurance company.
Absolutely.
If the general is out there looking for a spokesperson, do not contact Josh Allen.
Oh, man. Shaq is screwed. Pray for Shaq.
That's right.
#pray for Shaq.
Absolutely. I mean,
#pray for Shaq.
You really need to pray for Shaq. He's got the general. He's got Papa John's, which isn't the greatest brand to be associated with as well.
True.
Shaq's not putting his eggs in the right basket. Tony, that's a great one. The insurance curse. Love it. Baker, what a mess in Cleveland. Trading for Deshaun Watson, ruining the relationship with Baker Mayfield, not doing any due diligence on Deshaun Watson as well, I should mention. But mm-hmm. based on those Progressive commercials, Baker lives in the stadium. It's going to be tough to move out. We talked about how tough it is to move out for J.D. McKissick last week. Can you imagine moving out of a whole mm-hmm. stadium? Very difficult mm-hmm. for Baker. His wife lives there. In this housing market? No way.
I mean, what's the biggest problem with moving? It's stairs. All those right. stairs.
All those.
What about the 300 level situation? Yikes.
Rough week for Patrick Mahomes as well. You mentioned losing Tyreek Hill. Also got married.
Whoa. Speaking of
Eddie. We're going there, Tony.
Okay,
we're
Jack.
The insurance cars. Love it. Tony, my Hansel Award, I'm giving it to announcers. I think announcers are what's hot in the sports world. We have March Madness. Nothing beats a good March Madness buzzer beater call. But what I found fascinating with March Madness is Andrew Catalan during the first round announced a cheerleader getting the ball unstuck from a hoop. And he did it as if he was announcing like a giant moment in a sporting event, like a team winning the Super Bowl, or he announced a cheerleader like, this is her one shiny moment. He really poured it on. And it reminded me of, I love it when announcers announce things that aren't involved in the game as if they're involved in the game. So, for example, we had the cheerleader for Indiana, Kevin Harlan, last year for the Super Bowl, announcing the streaker on the field, I think during a radio broadcast. He's like, he's pulling down his pants and he's getting tackled by the security.
Someone has run on the field. Some guy with a bra, and now he's not being chased. He's running down the middle of the 40, arms in the air and a victory salute. He's pulling down his pants. Put up your pants, my man. Pull up those pants. He's being chased to the 30. He breaks a tackle from a security guard. The 20, down the middle, the 10, the 5. He slides at the 1, and they converge on him at the goal line. Pull up your pants, take off the bra, and be a man. And the players with hands on hips at the other end of the field are looking at him and shaking their head and saying, why, oh, why is this taking place in a Super Bowl?
And Kevin, if you're going to run that far, get into the end zone. Don't slide at the 1. You got to score. Once you got on the field, get into the end zone, my man.
Lord, now they're cuffing him. But pull up his drawers, whatever you do.
He's announcing it as if he's announcing the game. I think that's hilarious. I think announcers should do that more. I think they should announce things that aren't happening privy to the game and are happening outside as if they're big events.
Why even
stop? I did drop a Doug Whaley privy.
There you go. Why even stop at the game? Why not just announce it things at Wegmans? Why not just announce things in the car? Narrate your whole life and let us enjoy it.
Right. A whole Twitch stream about narrating your life. Why not announce like the food and beverage assortment for the press box? That would be great. We have ham sandwich today. Like, that would be hilarious. Nothing is better than announcers. I also like when announcers take a step to the side, bring in somebody off the cuff. During the Olympics, we had Snoop Dogg and Kevin Hart. Snoop Dogg's also announced LA Kings hockey games. Will Ferrell's been part of hockey games. I know, like, whenever they bring in an outside source, like regular sporting events bring in an outside source, it's gold every time. You can't get better than Snoop Dogg or Will Ferrell or whoever being in the announce booth. Eminem, when he was in an announce booth with Brent Musburger, I think it was, way back when for a college football game, it was 5 minutes of awkwardness, and that's gold for content. Announcers are having a week, Tony. We have Aikman and Buck moving from Fox to Monday Night Football. We have Tirico replacing Al Michaels. I think announcers are what's hot this week.
Great pick. And as you were talking, it was reminding me, as many of our listeners will remember, last night's Sabres game featured a lot of Will Arnett in the booth.
That's right.
You know, TNT. Interviewing Patrick Kane, Buffalo's own. Yikes.
That's right.
and so... And
touchy subject.
I did severely
shout out it. Shout then, out cab yeah, drivers out there everywhere.
Shout out cab drivers. We were there that night. Were you there that night?
I was not there. Tell us.
You were not there that night. We were there that night.
You were there.
Are you sure Patrick you weren't there Kane. That night?
You were. I was not.
Made
I
a mistake.
I yes, punched the cab driver.
Yes, we. Oh, that's what we're talking about.
What are you talking about?
I'm not talking about punching a cab driver. No, I'm talking about the sexual assault.
Oh no, I was not there. You were there.
Yeah, I was there that night.
Were you called to the courtroom as a witness?
No, I was not subpoenaed. I did have to fill out an affidavit to say that I was there, but we were too scared to talk to Patrick Kane, because all that happened was we walked by. My friend said to me, "Oh my God, it's Patrick Kane." And then we scurried over into the corner.
Rightfully so. Good call.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. You can't get too close to that sun.
No.
You'll burn your wings of pastrami on that.
That's right. That's right. Tony, that's what is hot. Listeners, we'll put it on Twitter. Give us your Hansel Award, who you think is hot in the sports world this week. But Tony, we got a lot of Bills to get into. Are you ready to talk some Buffalo Bills?
I've been ready since last recording. Let's dance.
Since 15 minutes ago when we started. Listeners, we will be back after the break. Take it away, Marv.
Go, go, Bills fight, Bills go. Come on, let's win for Buffalo.
And we are back. Tony, we got a lot of Bills news to get into, and we're going to start this week where we started last week, and that's the continuing Ryan Bates drama. Tony, I don't know if I can muster the strength to discuss it, because it has escalated since last week, and it has escalated in a big way.
I would say our cavalier, happy-go-lucky attitude is downright inappropriate for the tone of the times in this nation right now.
We need
over the Ryan Bates situation.
Exactly. We are not happy-go-lucky in this moment. We need a dire, a morose, whatever, however you want to describe our saddened state right now. We talked to last week how this he was visiting the Vikings. He also visited the Bears and the Patriots. And now it's a reality, Tony, that we could lose him, because he has an offer from the Bears and we have 5 days to match it. The countdown is on.
Matt, this is like how I have to imagine America was when Abraham Lincoln was shot and brought clinging to life across the street in his house. And everyone in America is just waiting, wondering, saddened, concerned, worried, all those emotions going through. It's basically also like, what if JFK didn't die instantly and we had to wait to see what was happening? That's basically the level that we're at here.
In this metaphor, are we Abraham Lincoln? Are we the ones almost dying?
Shouldn't you be wearing the bucket?
It is a very comparable metaphor.
Yeah, in this metaphor, we are America. Okay. And the president is Ryan Bates. But because he leaves, he will be dead to me. But yeah, he is our president in many
the
ways.
The Bears are John Wilkes Booth. One Bills Drive is Ford's Theater.
Yeah, that's a good one.
It's all matching up here.
Mm-hmm. I would say Soldier Field is Ford's Theater. It's not called Soldier Field anymore, but that's Ford's Theater.
Tony,
remember when they played in Champaign?
Oh, yeah. Champaign, Urbana.
Exactly.
Wild Tony, times. On a scale of 1 to 5, 5 being the most worried, where are you at with Ryan Bates' situation right now? We don't have the numbers, right? 2.2? You're not that worried?
Because I've already accepted the worst.
Wow. Oh, my God.
It's already, I've already just like, well, it's over.
You're already at the acceptance stage.
Yes. I mean, I would say I'm still more in the denials.
Okay.
No, I would say I'm a bargaining, because now my focus has shifted to what's the game plan? What are we going to do? Because there's no way in hell Cody Ford can just go out there and take care of business. That's not going to happen.
I don't care if there's a new O-line coach in Eric Cromer. Cody Ford is, this might be a freezing cold take 8 months from now, and I hope I'm right that it is, but I do not think Cody Ford is fixable despite the new offensive line coach, maybe a new offensive scheme, new offensive coordinator. Cody Ford just doesn't have it. Like, I'm sorry.
Cody Ford is not a beach chair. Aaron Cromer is not saving this.
Oh, boy. You really topped the Lincoln metaphor with the beach chair. All right. I don't know what it is with this organization and not valuing Ryan Bates correctly. For the longest time, they did not give him a chance, despite poor offensive line play from those ahead of him, a la Cody Ford, whoever else we mentioned, guys that are not on the team anymore, Feliciano-esque players. They finally give him a shot and the team excels and the offense looks fantastic. And he's versatile. He can play every line, every position on the offensive line. Do they value him? Like, I'm starting to question if they value him, Tony. They didn't tender him like with a second round grade, which would have avoided all of this because nobody's wasting a second round pick for Ryan Bates. And being really gambled with this one, thinking Bates wasn't valued throughout the league. But if you watch the Bills' last seven games, I can tell you you were wrong, Brandon Beane. People see the tape, and they value a guy who can play five different positions on the offensive line. Now we might lose him, especially with signing Saffold, which I like, but on a one-year deal. And the depth behind those offensive guards currently, say even we keep Ryan Bates, the depth behind the center currently, there's nothing there. The offensive line depth is a little lacking, and Ryan Bates fills every need. So I don't know how, I don't have the numbers. I don't think the numbers are out in terms of what the Bears offered him, but it sounds like it's going to be, rumors are that it's pretty front loaded, which is going to put Beane in a pickle here, handcuff him a little, because the Bills are very thin in terms of money available. They're right at the cap. So long story short, I'm extremely worried we're going to lose a player who seems to have been undervalued since they traded for him from the Eagles. And once he gets a shot, excels. What message does this send for the other players? You get your shot, you excel, and we're going to let you test the market, and we're not going to extend you and all this stuff. I just don't, I'm scared on all levels.
To me, I think the message is more positive. I think the message is, come to the Bills and become the best version of yourself, and then you'll go get your payday if you want it. But you're probably not going to want it because you probably want to stay here. Right.
Are you just hoping Ryan Bates, I mean, they have to match it now or they lose him. Like, it's not just whether he wants to stay here or not. He's not unrestricted.
Right. So, I mean, really, I would say that we're screwed and that's
short,
it.
Short, simple, not
we
sweet.
We can't afford. Yeah. We don't have the draft. We can't add another severe need to the draft. We can't afford anything else. Maybe figuring out a way to get Bucker back. I don't know. It's not a very timely situation. We're in a pickle, as you said. We're in a pickle.
What are some things that are more painful than losing Ryan Bates? Stepping on a Lego, pretty painful.
Oh, this is way worse than that. That's
finding out your baby collection is worthless after keeping them all these years.
I mean,
that's pretty painful.
I'd carry all my Beanie Babies through a field of Legos in my bare feet if it meant Ryan Bates was staying.
I'd like to see that. I think many would share in that sentiment, Tony.
Yeah.
So we are officially in panic mode, DEFCON 5, however code orange, like whatever the level of panic is, we are at the highest level of panic for our sweet prince, Ryan Bates. But 5 days, the countdown is on, Brandon Beane. Make it happen. Doesn't matter the price. The salary cap is this fictitious thing. Every team operates over it. Just whatever. Keep a good player who's versatile and can play every offensive position. I mean, they gave him a nickname. They gave him Rick Bates. You can't lose it. Mm-hmm. You give a nickname to like that.
That's a very good point. Very good point.
He's ingrained in the culture now with a name like Rick Bates. That's not his name. His name's Ryan, but you nicknamed him Rick. That means he's part of the family. He's part of Josh Allen's inner circle. You can't lose him. Can't lose him. Tony. Let's talk about moving on here. The release of Star Laettuale, we kind of called it. I mean, it came after a day after we recorded. Now with the signings of Daquan Jones and Tim Settle in this revamped defensive line, the writing seemed to be on the wall for Starletuile, and they made it happen again, like Cole Beasley, a little quicker than I thought. But they made the move. They saved $1.5 million in the cap, taking out all the dead cap money this year, so there's none next year. But I mean, this was inevitable. Star, his whole tenure, I feel like, with the Bills, pretty disappointing overall. I had high expectations when he came from Carolina that he would be a really good one technique, especially after he drafted Ed Oliver. Star would allow Ed Oliver to flourish, and we just learned that Ed Oliver would flourish on his own despite who was next to him, whether it was Starletuile, Harrison Phillips, Vernon Butler, etc. Of course, he opted out the COVID year, and it just seemed like Brandon Beane discussed with Cole Beasley during his press conference discussing free agency this past week. Brandon Beane viewed Cole Beasley and Starletuile as, it seemed like, as two guys that just, once the pandemic hit, just didn't seem like themselves, like never got back to where they thought the organization wanted them to be. So I'm not upset by Starletuile being released. I think their goal this offseason, Brandon Beane's goal and the front office's goal, was to revamp this offensive line. And this is just a piece of that puzzle. Defensive line.
Right.
Not offensive line.
I mean, I would say so, but for someone who was supposed to fill a role as like such an anchor in that go-to one tech that was going to sort of open up a world of possibilities and a labyrinth of ways to get to the quarterback, and then that kind of never happened. I mean, if you're gonna retool a defensive line, it's got to start there. That's getting rid of the core, the crux of it. That's taking care of business right from the source. So yeah, you got to do it. And I appreciate their boldness in doing it. And I don't feel like we're any worse for the wear afterwards. So another Beane triumph in my mind.
He came from Carolina with a heavy price tag, 5 years, $50 million. Like I said, never lived up to that. This season, after opting out last season due to COVID, he played in roughly 50% of snaps. Then he lost his starting job to Harrison Phillips, who really emerged last season and came into his own. And Star snap count went down to like below 30%. So I'm not paying a guy all that money to play 30% of snaps. In his three seasons with the Bills, he managed 8 tackles for losses and 5 sacks in that 3-year span. So just the production was never there. The expectations were never met for Star. And I'm actually a little nervous because we dipped our toes once in the one technique Carolina Panthers pool with Star. And now Daquan Jones, same situation, comes over one technique from Carolina. A little bit worried about there being a precedent with Star there. So hopefully Daquan Jones can right the wrongs, I guess, if you will.
That's what I'm thinking too. It's on Eric Washington, where Eric Washington's on notice with this whole thing. Like, it really is.
Which is that a good thing?
Well, that's the thing, is we're about to find out. Now they've really tooled things up to set him up for potential success.
Right.
And obviously, you know, he has input in the situation too. So he said, yes, I want Daquan in there. So I don't know. He knows. He has a vision. Let's see if it turns into success. Probably think yes. I mean, even when I would say the defensive line was like only kind of a success last year, but enough of a kind of to feel the need to like recharge and retool everything that's on it. But we're still also the number one defense. So who's to complain? They'll figure it out.
I think the goals were clear based on Brandon Beane's press conference in terms of how he wanted to retool this defensive line. And it was twofold. It was fixing the run defense, which is a clear weak point on this team, as the guys from last year just weren't cutting it. And that's been a consistent issue during Leslie Frazier's tenure as defense coordinator, is the run defense has been a little lackluster, if you will. And then I think the second goal for Brandon Beane was getting defensive ends, and he mentioned it verbatim, that can finish and make sacks. And I don't think that spells well for Jerry Hughes. I don't think that spells well for Mario Addison. That's why they brought Von Miller in. Brandon Beane mentioned it. It's a guy who can finish, and he's a proven commodity when it comes to getting to the quarterback. So, and that's absolutely what they did. And I think it was a point of emphasis this offseason. And I think Brandon Beane just flipped the script. He saw what they've been trying to do hasn't been working with the personnel they had. And it was time for a change. And I think, at least on paper, at least in the early goings of offseason, we'll see how it translates to the field. But on paper, it looks like he's successfully hit those two goals I think he set out for.
Yeah, I mean, in a big way. He's making big splashes. He's doing big things. Brandon Beane, I would say, also is having a moment right now. He's really getting a lot of attention and really putting himself out there in the spotlight, I would say. And, you know, a lot of hype surrounding the reception that he got at the tournament. And I think deservedly so. Like, this has been wild. This was an offseason I was dreading in the sense that reality was going to set in that we have a super crazy expensive quarterback, and how is that going to reverberate to the rest of the team? Like, this was the start of a de-evolution.
Right.
But, well, this de-evolution has, we're signing Von Miller. So, okay, now I don't know what to believe. Now I don't know what world I'm living in.
Well, in a fantasy world.
Mm-hmm.
Also, Brandon Beane having a moment, killing it on the Pat McAfee show this past week. I mean,
I thought you were going to say. Okay, yes.
Well, what did you think I was going to say?
Well, I thought that was going to be your segue into talking about Von Miller. First time at Wendell's Drive video.
We can talk about that too.
Let's get into it.
What do you want to get into?
If you want to, what were you going to say? What were you going to talk about with Pat McAfee?
I was just going to say, like, he was on Pat McAfee this past week, and I thought he was not only honest and open with his discussion, but just seemed like a cool guy. I thought he came off a really down to earth, smart guy. And you don't see that with a lot of like high level front office people in the NFL, talking about how he would trade himself before he would trade Josh Allen, talking about how he's like bitter towards the JD McKissick thing. And like we said last week, like, screw that guy. It seems like Brandon Beane's taking the same approach. He said on McAfee, quote, "I'm sure I'll get over that real quickly." So I just think he came off really well. He came off really well in the press conference announcing all the free agents. And I think, like you said, Brandon Beane's having a moment. Got the standing ovation at KeyBank during March Madness. Arkansas winning tonight against Gonzaga, a favorite for the national championship. The Beane effect is in effect with him and Eric Musselman taking a picture together while Arkansas was here for the first two rounds of the tournament. So Beane, I think you're right, is having a moment, a national moment.
I would say so. And what you were talking about with his demeanor on Pat McAfee, I think, is striving to have, you know, like the hit break the rules casual show, like a Howard Stern, even though he's not, personality is not really Howard Stern, but like, right. You know what I mean? Like, we're sitting on couches, you're slouching. Yeah. It's very casual.
Jock stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. And Beane just thrived in that. But Beane also thrives in a professional situation and dealing with different styles of members of the press. The guy's so versatile. And that's what is impressing me the most about him in this moment. He's the everyman, but for every kind of man.
That's right. That's a good point. And the everyman.
Guy's got a huge future in politics if he wants it.
Oh yeah.
He's really
he could be the mayor of this city. If he ran for mayor, he would win by a landslide. No question.
Oh, I think so too.
Mm-hmm. Easily. As long as he gets the city.
Or he would completely ruin his reputation and vilify himself. One of those two would think
so. I don't think so. I think he can do no wrong right now in the eyes of Bills fans and people of Buffalo.
Well, but if we go on the draft weekend and Cody Ford is in the starting slot, he will be doing wrong.
Okay, I'll give you that one. Yeah. I agree.
Okay.
But the everyman, of course, made a big signing last week. Von Miller is a Bill. And we got a little inside look of Von Miller's first day at One Bills Drive, being announced to the media, taking a tour of the facilities. Tony, I'm assuming you watched this video as I did. I don't know how I feel. I feel like Von wasn't really into it. And that scares me a little. And I don't know if that's just me having to learn his personality, and maybe he's just like a quiet demeanor kind of guy, and then a big personality on the field but quiet off the field kind of thing. It seemed like there was a lot of like, oh crap, I'm in Buffalo moments on his face. Like, that was a vibe I'm getting. And he came off very well to the media, but just him like touring the facility, and I don't know, maybe I'm looking way too much into it, and I probably am. And maybe it's just, hey, I've been in this league for 10, 11, 12 years now, and I've seen it all. So this is just riding the bike for me. It's nothing new. I wanted to see more excitement, I guess, is where I'm going with this.
I would say that I did not have that view. I had more the view that you said in the latter portion, that this guy, he came off as a veteran, as a consummate, experienced, seasoned professional. He knows what he cares about. He knows the right questions to ask. And all ultimately doesn't matter. He just wants to be like in, you know, his mode. He just wants to like know where it all happens, know where it's all going, knows what he's supposed to be doing. So he can worry about the real things and like be used to it instead of worrying too much about all the things he has to do to acclimate himself. And I think that was backed up by how his demeanor changed when he was filming on his phone. His demeanor changed in the press conference. He knew every situation. He knew how to handle it. He knew the right questions to ask because he's been in this situation before. And I think also the one thing that I think was like mildly deflating was when someone in the training center asked him about like pretty nice facilities, huh? And he's like, oh yeah, some of the nicest I've seen, of course. And I'm like, yeah, but like he just came from SoFi Stadium. Like that also is some of the nicest facilities in the NFL.
Probably.
Yeah. Not going, yeah, like while a lot of players are coming in and are going to be very impressed, maybe Von Miller is kind of just like used to a higher echelon right now. So that was just kind of like a reality check. But I think that that also contributes to maybe the vibe that you were getting about how he didn't seem that excited. I don't think players like that get excited. I think it's just, he's going to work. He just wants to make sure he knows how it works.
Yeah.
I appreciated his knowledge base and professionalism and not really being impressed by anything. I mean, he's on his ladder, you know, he's on the back nine right now.
He
knows.
Yeah, it did seem like he knew what he was doing, playing to Bill's Mafia with those, you know, Instagram reels or whatever he was posting on his phone.
He knew like when to pose with his jersey without being asked. Like he knew exactly.
He's been there.
Like, okay, now as photographers, and then I'll turn my smile off, and then I'll play with Jordan Poyer's golf clubs. And he knew. He knows what the job is.
Yeah. He's like, is this my locker? Is this where the pads go? Like you don't care about any of this, do you, Von?
I did think
it was funny as well. I thought it was funny, and this is another impression I got. It seemed like Beane was very nervous until that ink was on the paper. It seemed like he was kind of fidgety and pacing a little bit before Von signed his contract. God damn it, he better sign this or I'm going to look real bad. It seemed
that is 100% your Buffalo insecurity. That is not real.
Easily.
Yeah,
he didn't seem a little nervous to you that this guy was just, after the McKissick thing, this guy could like just turn around and say like, nah, not for me.
After the McKissick thing, I was a little bit worried. I'm like, oh geez, now we're going to lose everybody. Von Miller's gone. Everybody's gone. This is all going to be a problem.
It's all a conspiracy. It's an inside job.
And it's all for charity.
Screwing the Bills.
Inside job.
I was pretty mad about the McKissick thing. And then he was quoted this week as saying,
I was a Buffalo.
Like, I was a Buffalo, and I'm like, I feel okay, but does this guy think we're the Buffaloes? Like,
the evidence is there that he might.
It really is, right? Yeah. Wouldn't you say, like, I was a Bill, I was about to be a Bill? I feel better
about
that.
You might, but that's not what he's thinking.
No, I was a Buffalo. So, yeah, no, but Von Miller does put pen to paper, officially a Bill. Could not be more excited. Glad 40 is available. Sorry, Dion Lacy. 40's not your number this year when we resign you for the 12th time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, it's super exciting. I thought he came off well in the media. Again, seemed like a guy who's been through the motions, knows what he's doing. Just, I wanted to see a little more excitement, but you're absolutely right. That is the scorned Bills fan in me, in the pessimistic view I have of everything. But it's a reality, and I hope it translates on the field. Tony, I would say, let's say a couple new faces were signed this week. A couple of familiar faces, getting the band back together. Let's start with the new faces, though. Duke Johnson, Jameson Crowder, and Greg Mancz. I think I'm pronouncing that correctly. Offensive lineman. By the way, there's never been a more Greg Mancz looking guy than Greg Mancz. You saw that guy, and you're like, that is the perfect
name Greg Mancz
guy.
Yeah,
yep. Greg Mancz. Also, if you're an offensive lineman, Tommy Doyle set the bar, set the standard. You sign your contract fully uniformed if you're an offensive lineman. Roger Saffold, I forgot to mention this with Saffold too. Tommy Doyle did it. That's the bar that's set. You got a full uniform signing the contract if you're an offensive lineman from here on out. Any of these three guys, I mean, obviously not Greg Mancz because he's Greg Mancz, but Duke Johnson or Jameson Crowder, he's a Greg Mancz looking guy. I can't get excited for that. I hope he's good depth. Duke Johnson, Jameson Crowder, any of these guys excite you? I would say I'm excited for Jameson Crowder. I always like Jameson
Crowder.
Interesting. Duke Johnson, I think, was a plan B from McKissick. So same type of player. Obviously, again, Brandon Beane had a vision for what he wanted his third down back to be. And Duke Johnson kind of had like a revitalization of his career in Miami last year. So I like the timing we're getting him at. But Jameson Crowder is the one that stands out for me because I've liked him ever since his days in Washington. I liked him even with a piss poor Jets offense for the last couple of years. He was torching the Bills, not last year's game, but I think the previous year opener. He was destroying the Bills. I like that signing the most. So what are your thoughts about any of these guys?
Well, my thoughts really are, these are not signings that are altogether that worth being excited about. I mean, in the form of Duke Johnson and Jameson Crowder.
Like, Duke to me, Williams, these, unfortunately.
Right, not Duke Williams. I'm going to mispronounce it a bajillion times. I'm going to say many, many
Duke
times.
Duke Preston.
But
I've had a lot of Dukes.
We have had a weird amount of Dukes holding the Duke for the Bills. I would say I'm not that excited. To me, these are like Josh Norman type signings, veteran in the room kind of signings. Yeah. We know maybe they're not what they once were, but they are names. And I would say that my concern with Jameson Crowder is his injury history, but that's to me also a blessing in disguise as someone who really likes Isaiah McKenzie. And that's only going to then give him the chance. So in that sense, I like that.
I like that he gets injured.
Yeah. I like a player who gets injured often. I would say I like the Jameson Crowder scene. I have this vision of Jameson Crowder, the stereotype that I developed in my mind. And I don't know if it is even able to be backed up. I don't know if there's any truth to it, but in my mind, he has a lot of drops. In my mind, and maybe I'm just kind of thinking, you know, maybe it's just like one Jets game and I just envision him dropping a ball or two. And that's like where it was created from. But in my mind, I'm like, oh, we just signed early Josh Reed, basically, with this. Wow. So
that is a comparison.
That is a comparison. But I would say that, you know, if we can keep him healthy, if he can return to form when he left Washington, when he was like insanely hyped up as someone who's going to have a big payday in free agency, then it's going to go well. I'm not going to complain about having talent on the team, especially if he stays healthy and stays a contributor. But now it's really just on
Ken Dorsey.
Yes, that's exactly the name I'm trying to think of. Not Duke Williams, but Ken Dorsey. To balance this thing out right and to utilize the weapons that we have. But really, he's a Sean McDermott guy. Like, he's just solid player. Not going to mess up that much. Happy to have him. But it's a little bit deflating because I still am hoping for a pretty highly drafted receiver. And I still kind of anticipate a pretty highly drafted receiver. Ideally, someone with some super speed and super talent. Yeah. That's what I'm looking for. And that's not Jameson Crowder, but, you know, it's nice to have some depth.
Yeah, absolutely. And he's a guy who's, like I said,
situational.
Yeah, I think that's the most important thing. Yeah, no, I think you're exactly right. The versatility that these two guys, they might not be impactful holistically in the offensive scheme of things, but I think these two signings are very good role players who give Dorsey all the tools that he needs to mold his offense how he envisions it. They can run screens for Duke Johnson. They can run McKenzie on crossing routes. They can run Crowder on short slants and soft zone stuff. And they can run two tight end sets now with OJ Howard. We're just giving Dorsey all the weapons possible.
All the tools in the toolbox.
For him to formulate his offense and make it a success, which I have no doubt it will be with Josh at the helm, obviously. Mm-hmm. But Jameson Crowder is a guy who has produced on those very poor offensively challenged Jets teams these past couple of years. 2019, he had over 70 catches with Sam Darnold and Luke Falk and Trevor Siemian throwing him the ball. So that's impressive in its own right. 50 plus catches last year with Mike White and Zach Wilson. I mean, he's never had a good quarterback in New York.
Oh, man.
Been...
I forgot about Mike White.
I can never forget about Mike White because he helped me win my Survivor pool last year. So.
Oh, okay.
Shout out to Mike White.
Shout out Mike White.
Our favorite White of them all.
Touchy subject. I would say my favorite White is Mr. White from That Thing You Do.
Oh, okay. I thought you were going to just go Tre'Davious White. Simple answer as always, but That Thing You Do is a great
movie.
Too
obvious.
So I don't blame you.
This is the Witty Not Funny Sports podcast, not the low-hanging fruit podcast.
That's next week.
Yeah. Witty Not Funny presents low-hanging fruit, the podcast.
It's just like 10 minutes of just the most obvious subjects and discussion about those obvious subjects.
Right.
But you guys, I feel low risk, high reward, signed a vet minimums. Crowder, 1 year, $2 million. Duke Johnson, 1 year, $1.2 million. So not breaking the bank in any way, shape, or form. So yeah, those are the new faces. But Tony, let's get to some familiar faces. Matt Barkley, and we briefly touched on it last week, but let's talk about it a little more in depth. Jordan Phillips and Shaq Lawson, all back in the fold. They're getting the...
And Tywon Jones.
And, oh, I know, but I don't like Tywon Jones, so I don't want to mention it.
Well, I do like Tywon Jones. I care about special teams. You're so ignorant.
I know. I'm just hoping we score a touchdown every drive, and special teams is just like this mute point. But, okay, we'll include Tywon Jones.
He's on the 53. Get him in here.
He's Matt Barkley, Shaq Lawson, Jordan Phillips, and Tywon Jones, I guess. But I like, again, vet minimum deals. I like that we're bringing guys who, and Beane spoke about this at his press conference as well, guys who want to be here. When he's talking about Cole Beasley and Stars, maybe guys who needed a change of scenery, who maybe their mind wasn't fully in the organization due to the COVID issues and they're off the field, whatever's going on off the field with those guys. Now we're getting back Jordan Phillips, Shaq Lawson, Matt Barkley, the glory years of the McDermott era. But guys who really ingrained themselves into the culture of Buffalo when they were here, I thought. Obviously, when they left, the financials didn't work out in their favor, but now they're back. And it seems like, and maybe this is just dialogue they were giving to the media and bullet points for the media to write their articles with, but it seems like these guys wanted to be here because they miss Buffalo. Like Shaq Lawson talked about how he's never had a good wing since he left Buffalo. And Jordan Phillips was recruiting Shaq Lawson and Josh talking to Josh Allen on the golf course or whatever. That was Von Miller. See, I'm getting them all mixed up now. Josh Allen's recruiting Von Miller on the golf course. But we talked about, like with McKenzie last week, a loyalty factor and a guys who want to be here. And it seems like Barkley, Lawson, and Phillips, definitely guys who wanted to be with this organization because they see really good things, even better things, I should say, from when they left.
With Barkley coming back, it shows to me that we were right to be worried about the QB room, in the sense that we're measuring the QB room on Josh's happiness personally, basically.
That's what it's all about.
And that we were right. And then we were worried about Josh, like all of Josh's friends are gone. And now he's just in there alone, all lonely. And he'll have to make new friends, whoever comes in. Well, now it's a familiar face. Now it's his old buddy. We know that that friendship, that whole dynamic works. So that's great. Case Keenum, another person who I think is in sort of like that mindset of, he's a veteran, he's 34, he knows what's going on, but he's seemingly a nice, personable guy. So it seems like he's going to be a good fit in that room too. So I'm excited to have him. And it's just good that I think it's a dynamic that I know is satisfying the situation because of what we already know about the relationship of Josh and Matt Barkley. So I'm definitely happy to have Matt Barkley back, and it makes it seem like, okay, now we don't have to be worried about the QB room anymore.
I think the trade for Case Keenum was really good, only giving up a 7th-round pick. Obviously, the dysfunction in Cleveland that is going on with their QB situation, the Brandon Beane pounced on that for nothing. I mean, a 7th-round pick
wasn't making the team anyway.
Yeah, exactly. It's highly unlikely that he makes the team, let alone makes an impact. But and now you get a guy in Case Keenum who has playoff experience. Of course, you have to go back to that last second touchdown to Diggs in the playoffs a couple of years ago with the Vikings. He's a guy that's been in offensive systems that have been successful with Kevin Stefanski last year. Went 2-0 with the Browns when he had to come in for Baker. So undefeated last year, just saying. So good pickup there, Brandon Beane, in Case Keenum. But again, a veteran presence and a guy who I think can come in if need be and win some games. So I really like the trade.
You know,
the QB room is now full and Matt Barkley's back with his buddy Josh Allen. The Hibachi boys are back. Get pumped for that. Love the Hibachi boys. So hopefully we
get
around
pumped for the Hibachi boys.
Love the Hibachi boys.
Now the Hibachi boys.
Josh Allen, Matt Barkley, some onion towers, some fire, some smiley face sake on the grill. It's all gravy, Tony. I love it.
See, I think the Hibachi boys sounds like a Japanese young adult novel series of detectives.
Are you saying we should develop this Hibachi boys
searching for? I'm saying it's the first Witty Not Funny miniseries that's gonna hit the listeners and hit them hard. It's the Hibachi boys.
What was that like? Who are the brothers, the detective brothers? the books we read growing up.
Hardy Boys?
The Hardy Boys, yeah. This could be a spinoff of the Hardy Boys.
The Hibachi Brothers. Yeah.
Right. Yes, the Japanese Hardy Boys. That's right. I was thinking the South Park Hardly Boys.
Oh, okay. I don't watch enough South Park to know what you're talking about.
It was a spoof of the Hardy Boys.
Well, I picked that up, man.
Yeah, yeah. I knew you would.
I couldn't first. A mystery that needed to be conquered by the Hibachi Brothers.
The Hibachi Brothers. Josh is
the Hibachi Boys. Yeah, the Hibachi Boys.
It's all good. As long as Josh is happy, I'm happy. And I think you are as well.
I would say that's my measure of, that's my measure of satisfaction with life. Josh is happy. Tony's happy.
Yeah, I think that's a good bar to set. Jordan Phillips, Shaq Lawson, you glad to see them back? I know we briefly mentioned it last week, but again, guys who left for financial reasons, got a good payday on other teams, did not find success in those other situations. But when they were here, very good. 2019, Jordan Phillips had 9.5 sacks, which was second among defensive tackles, 13 tackles for losses. In comparison, when his 2 years with the Cardinals, he played in just 9 games, which maybe the injuries are catching up with him now, but he only totaled 5 sacks and 4 tackles for losses in 2 years. So again, a guy who seemingly wanted to be here. He claims he watched every Bills game the past 2 years. He keeps in touch with the guys constantly. Yeah, he's a fan. But I liked what he said.
Hang out and start a Bills fan podcast together.
Well, we don't want any rivals or competition in our podcast, don't we? But I did like what Jordan Phillips said in his reintroductory press conference. I don't know how that works, but in his press conference when he was signed, talking about how even though he left, it still kept in touch with the guys, close-knit group. And when he was with the Bills during his first run, he said it was the first time he really felt like it was more than a football team and it was more like a family. So I think that's the culture we obviously know the McBean dream team is going for with the process and everything. This isn't just a football team, it's a family kind of vibe. So it seems like Shaq Lawson, Jordan Phillips are resonating that message in coming back to the Bills. How do you feel about it?
I think it's great. You know, as I said last week, the thing that resonates with me is about when Jordan Phillips signed and he spoke and he had his message for Shaq Lawson, Shaq signed the contract, like as though to say, Shaq, are you crazy? Like, why are you dawdling? Like, we're going home. We finally have the chance to go home. We once were lost and now are found. Let's just go home.
Yeah.
And we can go home together. And so it's a testament to their, it's a testament to their friendship. It's a testament to what the Bills mean to them. And I think that's kind of the hope of the Buffalo psyche, is that like, that's what we want the Bills to be. And they are, and it's cool. And that's why we like them.
I think it's also a testament to how the organization is now viewed throughout the league. So what once was kind of the doldrums of the NFL, an organization that players did not seek out or did not want to play for, is now the exact opposite. So again, just it speaks to what Brandon Beane and Sean McDermott have put together here in their past 5 years. So I like to see, I think with now Phillips and Lawson in the mix, I think this defensive line being completely retooled, I'm very excited to see what the finished product is going to be. So I'm all for this. If Jordan Phillips is your fourth defensive tackle and he can give you 75% of what he gave you that 2019 season, which I think it's safe to say was his best season, then that's really good value to me.
Absolutely. And the rotation is so much stronger now. And like, I have so much more confidence in the rotation, because even when we would be in the rotation, it's like, oh, stars out there. Okay. Like, this is like rotating in, but it's like, this might not be great. Or like, this is, you know, a necessary evil in it. Or even when Vernon Butler was out there, more so.
Right.
It's like, okay, like here's one of these snaps that's a necessary evil of the rotation. I feel like I'm at the Brazilian steakhouse. Oh, yeah. Oh, this steak is up next. Oh, this beef is up next. Oh, you're telling me this sirloin's up next? I want the rotation always, because I'm always going to be looking for the next one. Because I'm excited about all the players in the rotation.
You're not flipping your card from green to red. You're staying green the whole time.
I am staying green until the numbers on the scoreboard are 0000.
Give me the meats. Keep them coming. Rotate them in.
Absolutely. And his name is Jordan Davis.
Oh, wow. That'd be amazing, actually.
You want to really hype up the rotation. Drop that bomb on us.
You really want to shut down the Brazilian steakhouse, you go get Jordan Phillips.
Yeah, you
or Jordan Davis.
Yeah, Jordan Davis. Yeah.
So we look at all these guys that have been signed free agency, guys that have been brought back, guys that are departing. Tony, wrapping up our Bills talk this week, the roster is pretty full, and we have the draft coming up in a month, and that'll fill a lot of needs, I hope. But we kind of know what this roster is shaping up to look like now. What is the one thing that sticks out to you in terms of still a major need on this roster for the Bills?
Oh, I mean, I think it's staring us in the face. It's got to be cornerback. The CB situation is CB, crappy and bad. I mean, we are looking at...
CB is CB.
We are looking at a world where Saran Neal is going to be starting games on purpose. And we gotta clean this thing up. Like, the depth was bad last year, and now it's really bad. So I look forward to drafting many, signing many, figuring that out. If I have to choose one, I have three major concerns, but if I have to choose one, it's got to be cornerback.
Yeah, I think it sticks out like a sore thumb. Very, very thin at cornerback. Losing Levi Wallace to the Steelers this offseason. Tre'Davious White, of course, his ACL injury probably won't be back till Thanksgiving, if we're lucky at this rate. So Dane Jackson played well when he spelled Trey White last year in a number two role. So obviously Dane Jackson's back, but really it's only Dane Jackson and Cam Lewis, who has had very limited time in terms of game action. I like Cam Lewis. I've liked him every time he's been out there, but if you thrust him into a starting role and having to cover Tyreek Hill twice a year now, Tyreek Hill's in Miami, that's a little scary. So Dane Jackson, Cam Lewis, and then you're looking at a bunch of undrafted guys from last year, Nick McCloud, Elijah Griffin. So it's extremely thin, extremely inexperienced. I think they gotta, like, that's gotta be where they go in the draft.
It's a huge priority.
It's a huge priority. And it
and
sounds like
on it working out.
Right. Which is the bet when it comes to every draft pick. You just hope it works out the best it can.
Well, no, I don't mean the player. I mean the way the draft board falls.
Oh, yes.
I mean, I don't want to get to 25 and then all of a sudden, you know, there was a run on corners at the beginning and now we're hosed.
Right. So a little concerning. It sounds like Brandon Beane. I mean, he's quoted as saying, I don't think he's ever done, but he's quoted as saying pretty much done with free agency. And it seems like they're focusing on the draft now. So I don't know if they bring in that veteran corner. I don't know if they bring in that Kevin Johnson or Josh Norman or whoever. So it may be the priority in the draft. We'll see. But yes, it's cornerback. And not only CB1, but CB2 and trickling down to every CB position is quite concerning, because that position is currently extremely thin for the Bills. Tony, that's all I have for Bills news. Anything else you want to touch on before we wrap it up here?
No.
Very decisive.
Yep,
that's it. That's it for Bills news this week. We will be back after a word from our sponsor giving you some parting gifts.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but my drink is so delightfully cold thanks to Traveling Growler. And since we know place to go, keep it cold, keep it cold, keep it cold with a Traveling Growler koozie. Koozie starting at just $5. Check out www.travelinggrowler.com today. And now back to the show.
And we are back, Tony, wrapping up the episode. Let's send the listeners off, send Witty Nation off with a parting gift. Of course, we're the self-proclaimed number one podcast in sports, but also in entertainment. So Tony, let's give them something they can take into the weekend that is outside of sports. Of course, you got March Madness going on and whatever else, Sabres hot streak and whatever free agent. Sports are around and they're pretty prevalent right now, but let's give them something outside of sports. Tony, what is your parting gift for the listeners?
I mean, if you're looking for escapism, if you're looking to have a bingeable show that is going to just melt your mind, I recommend Severance, a new show on Apple TV. Ooh. It was heavily touted because it's being made by Ben Stiller, but it is a hard drama.
Yeah, that
has a lot. Adam Scott's in it. Yeah. Adam Scott is your lead. Yep. John Turturro is in the mix.
Ooh.
It's super good. Everyone should watch it. It's super good.
What's it about?
Matt, it is about the work of a company that has developed a severance procedure, which not severance like a severance package, but it severs the memories of your home life and your work life. So when you come to work, you don't remember what's happening at home. And when you go home, you don't remember what happened at work.
Sounds interesting.
It's very interesting about the effects of that sort of sociologically and how the company becomes a microcosm, because the company is these people's whole world. They don't know anything outside of their office. So except for that something exists that they don't know about. So it really is the effects of that sociological, you know, environment that I guess they're in, and all the, and how that reverberates to their personalities, to the culture, to the geography. It's wild.
Interesting. You know, what's crazy to me is Adam Scott, Ben Stiller produced it, created it, directs, whatever. John Turturro, also pretty funny guy. Big Lebowski.
Yeah, a veteran.
Mr. Deeds. And the plot. Yeah, Mr. Deeds. And the plot you just described, it sounds like it would make a perfect comedy show.
I know. You might think maybe that's how it started, but it is. No one's laughed. There's not very many laughs to be had in this thing, but it's super good.
Sounds good. All right. That is Severance on Apple TV. Check it out. Tony, I'm going to the music world. I'm going with a rapper I discovered through our friends group. A guy by the name of 645AR. Tony, I gave you a little sample. I'll put a little sample for the listeners here. I don't know how to describe 645AR. When you first pull up a song, the beat is hard. It's very street. It's very like, feels like hardcore rap, like Wu-Tang-esque. And then he starts rapping and he sounds like a chipmunk. And you can't understand a word he's saying. If you watch a video of 645AR on YouTube and try to pull up the captions aren't even available because the captions don't even know what he's saying. His voice is so high-pitched, so chipmunky is really the only way to describe it, that you have no idea what this man is saying. So it is one of the funnier things. It's so ludicrous and ridiculous that it seems like a parody of like rappers. Like this guy can't be serious. Like he is Little Dicky, even like a, and Dave, is that like a parody of rappers? Because he's like a legit rapper.
No, he's a real rapper.
Yeah,
he's legit.
Like I guess like the Weird Al of rapping. I don't like, it just seems like a
Weird Al
when you hear this guy rap. Who does parodies of things? So
but are they doing parodies?
It feels like it. It feels like this is to make a joke of the rap game. Like, I don't know. I gave you a listen to it before we recorded here.
It was wild.
It is wild. It was very funny. Again, the beat comes hard. You think it's going to be something. And then the man is just inaudible, like not understanding anything. Like just it's hilarious. And I hope, like I said, I'll put in a sample for the listeners. It's great. Tony, are you a 645AR fan now that I've introduced you to him?
I am their newest fan. I am their biggest fan.
Tony's going to buy every album they have ever made.
I'm gonna get a custom Bills jersey that says
645.
It'll be the number 645 and the nameplate will say AR.
That I think that'd be legit. It's probably one of the better custom jerseys. I've seen some I've seen some doozy.
Of course. We'll have to draft that.
We should do like top custom jerseys. Top
we've seen around
jersey series.
Yeah, that's
what I mean. So yeah, those are our parting gifts for the listeners. Check them out. Let's wrap it up though, Tony. Thank you, of course, to our sponsor, Traveling Growler, www.travelinggrowler.com. Koozies starting at just $5. Koozies for bottles, cans, koozies for growlers, and all cool designs, holiday designs, festive designs, just cool artistic designs. www.travelinggrowler. Check it out. Where to find the t-shirt store first. T-shirt store, teespring.com. Search Witty Not Funny, all in word. Support the podcast. T-shirts, just $20. We have hoodies. We have tanks. We have long sleeve. We have non-hooded sweatshirts. What are those called? Just sweatshirts, I guess. It's late. I don't know. My mind is wandering. Let's support the podcast. TeeSpringDuck. Search Witty Not Funny, all one word. Where to find the podcast? You can find the podcast on the Built in Buffalo Podcast Network, dropping every Sunday. subscribe, follow. You can find us on iTunes, Spotify, iHeartRadio, anywhere your fine podcasts are listened to for free by also searching Witty Not Funny, all one word. Also on YouTube now, on the Built in Buffalo YouTube page. Over 300 views, our last video, which is our first YouTube video. So thank you to everyone who checked us out on YouTube last week's episode. Appreciate that. We always like to say around here, whether you give us 2 minutes or 2 hours of your time, we greatly appreciate it. So if you're a first-time listener, thank you for checking us out. Hope you enjoyed it. Stick around. More to come, better things to come in the following weeks. But Built in Buffalo Podcast Network is the main spot, at Built in Buffalo _. Tony, Twitter handle, where can the listeners find you?
At TonyJAmbrose. That's at Tony J. Ambrose in Twitter.
Jambrose on Twitter. You find the podcast at Witty Sports 716 on Twitter, on Instagram, Facebook page as well. Witty Not Funny Sports. Check us out, follow us everywhere, subscribe, like, appreciate all the support. All we have is a send off for the listeners. Tony, what do you have this week? What wise words can you pass along?
Ooh, wisdom. You know, just live your life on the dance floor like the fire's burning, because that Shorty's fire burning. Who sings it? It's a throwback to the song.
It's a good callback. Who sings the song? It is Sean Kingston, right? That's right.
Yeah.
Yes. Sean Kingston. That is right. Good callback. And as I always say, stay witty out there, everyone. Thanks for listening. Go Bills. Peace.
Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Marshawn is a fresher breath there. He just loved chain restaurants.
Matter of fact, he ate at Applebee's 12 times during the bye week.
I love each and every most of you guys.
That really is still swollen, isn't it?
It
kind of looks like a football, actually.
Thank you for that.
Stitching, you got it.
Thank you.
Hey, D, I like donuts, baby. Let's go.
Stay focused. Work hard in school. You might not like school, but make sure you're working hard at school.
It builds a bomb. It builds a bomb.
It's your boy DM3, and you're listening to the Witty Not Funny Sports Podcast on the Built in Buffalo Podcast Network.